This is Duke University.
This is part of our Humanities Writ Large Mass Incarceration and the Carceral State Lecture Series. This is the second talk in the series. We're so glad that people have shown up for this. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Jessica Namical. I am an assistant professor of the practice in International Comparative Studies and Women's Studies, and along with Matt Witt, who is a postdoctoral teaching fellow in the Thompson Writing Program, have put this program together with a few other organizers, Douglas Campbell, who is here, Robin Kirk, and Juanima Lubiano. So before I introduce our speakers, we're going to get right into it tonight. I want to thank our sponsors, which is the Humanities Writ Large, the Human Rights Center at the Franklin Humanities Institute, International Comparative Studies, the Department of History, the Program in Women's Studies, and the Franklin Humanities Institute. So thank you to all of the sponsors. So kindly joining us from Emory University is Daniel LaChance, who is assistant professor there in history. He is the author of the forthcoming book, Executing Freedom, The Cultural Life of Capital Punishment in the United States, which will be published by the University of Chicago Press in the fall of 2016. So keep your eyes open for that.
So thanks for having me. And so today I'm going to talk a little bit about the cultural life of capital punishment in the United States, focusing predominantly on a period between World War I and World War II, but then considering towards the end of the talk the implications of the arguments that I'm making about that period are for thinking about the death penalty in America today. So let's go back to the 19th century. And over the course of that long century, elites in the United States increasingly sought to make executions into private, efficient, and highly professional affairs. There was a fear that executions had become unwieldy public spectacles, and that drove state actors to move these events into jail yards at first. And then with the advent of new technologies like the electric chair and the gas chamber, into the interior of centralized prisons that were often far away from the county in which the crime that was being punished had occurred. Access to executions was dramatically curtailed for the public, limited in most places to male professionals who would serve as official witnesses for the state. This dramatic transformation of executions reflected and reinforced an emerging image of the state as an abstract entity rather than a set of particular persons like the local sheriff or the local prosecutor who were governing in a more unsystematic way. Stuart Banner, a historian of the death penalty, has argued that by the end of this era of public executions, everyday Americans became distanced from the killing state, right? That's the term that folks in law and society studies use to refer to the state that puts some condemned people to death. The state, Banner argued, began to seem more and more distant and detached. Quote, with executions conducted behind closed doors before a small group of well-connected people out of the public eye, the people were no longer punishing the criminal. Now the government was doing the punishing, and the people were reading about it later. After this period of change, execution ceremonies had so thoroughly changed that by the 1950s, those opposed to the death penalty were beginning to cite their hyper-rationality as evidence of their inhumanity. Reflecting on his years as the death row chaplain at San Quentin Prison in California in a 1962 memoir, Byron Eshelman told his readers, quote, the death penalty is routine, even-tempered, assembly line annihilation. The state has become a legal murder incorporated. But while those who opposed the death penalty were arguing that the modes, the protocols, and the settings of state killing were becoming chillingly cold-blooded, they were up against the existence and with the birth of film, the expansion of popular fictional and non-fictional renderings of the death penalty aimed at maintaining the execution ceremony as a sacred event that took into account the uniqueness of the offender and the uniqueness of the persons who were putting the offender to death. After the public could no longer directly witness executions, these fictional and non-fictional accounts became for most people the sole source of knowledge about what happened when a person was put to death in America. For the public, access to executions was disappearing, but access to representations of executions was expanding. In the 1920s, Broadway stages hosted a number of successful productions with plots that centered on the fate of condemned white men. Those plays were often produced in other cities like Atlanta, Los Angeles, and Chicago. But much more importantly, the birth of film and its development into a storytelling medium led to the production of nationally circulating, wide-reaching stories about capital punishment. Between World War I and World War II, at least 132 films with capital punishment at the center of the plot were produced in the United States. Finally, newspapers across the country took some capital cases, inevitably those of young white men, and lavished attention on their dramatic conclusions in execution chambers. These fictional and non-fictional accounts shared a lot in common. Most importantly, they took a punishment that was most often endured by African Americans and used it to create riveting stories about the souls of white men, how those men coped with the inevitability of death, how they managed the vagaries of fate, how transcendent or ephemeral the ties that they had with their loved ones were. These representations were shaped by the conventions of the melodrama. Melodrama is a popular literary genre of the time, and it expressed the anxieties more generally of the age, the political, psychological, social, and economic upheavals that had occurred for Americans in the period leading up to the turn of the 20th century. More Americans than ever before were living in cities and grappling with the anonymizing nature of urban life. New industrial technology posed threats to the integrity of both the body and the soul. Commercially driven values of the capitalist marketplace were displacing a morality that had traditionally been centered in rural family life. And the life of the wage laborer was one of constant economic insecurity. In the threats faced by the innocent in melodramatic texts, right, you can think of those images that we all have of the woman who's tied to the railroad tracks while a train comes barreling down after her, stories about people who are destitute and unable to pay the rent, who are being evicted from their homes, stories of young women who move to the city and are sexually exploited by cunning cosmopolitan Lotharios. These are the standard plots of melodrama, and we can perceive in them modern anxieties about the fate of the pre-modern self in the modern world. But in resolutions where the wicked were punished and the innocent saved, melodramas ultimately reassured audiences that, quote, a higher cosmic moral force still looked down on the world and governed it with an ultimately just hand. So these texts, they reflected the anxiety of the age, but they were also a coping mechanism for handling and managing that anxiety. It's not surprising, given the nature of the melodrama, that playwrights, screenwriters, and journalists were often drawn to stories set in the shadow of the gallows. The emotional devastation of a death sentence, the thrilling suspense and pathos that's generated by preparations for an execution, the thoroughly external threat that execution devices pose to living beings, the guarantee of an outcome of enormous consequence, all of these elements were low-hanging fruit to a melodramatically minded author in search of a plot. But I want to suggest that, like the dangers of the oncoming train or the sheriff approaching the house with an eviction notice, the impending execution was much more than just a vehicle for achieving cheap thrills. Like other melodramas, it was a manifestation of a uniquely modern anxiety, the survival of a unique and spiritual self in the face of modern forms and technologies of governance that threaten to objectify it. And like other melodramas, execution tales work to mitigate those modern anxieties. Fictional and non-fictional narratives of state killing heaped attention onto the soul of the state actors who carried out executions, as well as the men who put them to death. As a result, the modern feeling that was slowly transforming death work in the United States was symbolically countered by a rising cultural construction of capital punishment as a sanction that did not forget the humanity of those who were put to death or of those who were doing the killing. In the popular imagination, the practice of capital punishment became surrounded by a melodramatic buffer that maintained executions as events in which the humanity of the state that killed and the condemned who died was constantly foregrounded, even as the methods of extinguishing life became increasingly efficient, cold-blooded, and machine-like. So I'm going to talk first about newspaper coverage and the way that newspapers depicted melodramatically execution scenes that occurred in actual execution chambers across the country. I worked with undergraduates at Princeton and at Emory, and we've looked at coverage of executions from this period from six daily newspapers as well as that of DC. So far, we've amassed about 1,700 stories of execution and analyzed them. And about 15% of them are really long. They're really long and involved and melodramatic. And almost all of those 15% of executions that received lavish front page coverage, they were all of young white men who were put to death. The coverage of white men's executions could be lavishly written. Sometimes it was accompanied by photography, as you can see here, and placed on the front page. This is the coverage of the Atlanta Constitution of Mel Gore's execution in Georgia's electric chair in 1927. And the coverage exemplified the extremes to which journalists would sometimes go in their accounts of white executions. Gore was one of a number of men who was convicted of murdering an Atlanta grocer in December of 1925, and he had been sentenced to death for the crime. As his execution date neared, the newspaper worked overtime to help readers appreciate, yet also traverse, the cosmic distance between themselves and the soon-to-be-dead Mel Gore. In an article previewing his execution titled "Doors of the Death House Shut Behind Mel Gore," journalist Loy Warwick wrote, "The last watch has begun for Mel Gore." He continued, "Alone and helpless in the dread silence of the death cell, he awaits the coming of that awful hour which will be his last upon this earth. The heavy steel door of the cell of the condemned in Milledgeville Penitentiary clanged behind the youth Saturday afternoon, and he was left alone with the horrible realization that he had been brought here to await the hour of his death, when the sizzling current charges through his veins and nerves, claiming payment of the debt which society says he must repay with his life." Months later, after an unsuccessful set of appeals, the paper wrote that Gore would, quote, "see the sun light up the skies in the east for the last time, and will see that sun cast before his eyes the sickening and sinister shadow of the electric chair in which at the hour of noon he will expiate with his life his crime against the laws of his fellow men." The paper encouraged empathetic identification with Gore. His crime was described without any sensationalism and with no mention of the family or friends that his robbery victim had left behind. Nowadays, execution stories almost always mention the response of the victim's families if they're written with any depth. None such consideration happened in these articles. The paper uncritically presented Gore's claim that he was not the shooter and did not know that a gun would be used during the robbery. Gore's appearance, right, he's in the middle there, was praised. "He is still the same natty, sleek-haired youth when he entered the victim's store. His carefully pressed blue trousers, his fancy hose, polished shoes, and general neatness have been kept up. There was nothing of the hangdog about him, nor was there anything boastful," readers were told. Gore looked in these accounts less like a hardened criminal and more like any average sympathetic boy might. Readers, moreover, got a close-up and personal glimpse into the anguish that his execution was causing the members of his family. An entire article was dedicated to covering Gore's mother's request to the governor for clemency. Quote, "An elderly woman with a pencil in her quivering hands and tears in her eyes, Mrs. J.B. Gore sat in the reception room of Fulton Tower, writing the words that she felt were wound around her very heart, pouring out her soul for her doomed son in an appeal for sympathy, prayer, and understanding." And then the paper went on to reproduce word for word the entirety of the woman's letter to the governor. Every detail was labored over in the account of Gore's final hours, from the sigh he made when the barber's dull clippers began to shave his head, to the drone of electricity that, quote, "wrote the receipt on Mel Gore's debt to society and announced," quote, "that the account was closed." The scientific mixed with the spiritual, as readers were told that, quote, "servants of society had scientifically dispatched that soul on its last long journey by applying 1,900 volts of harnessed electricity through a creation of science known as the electric chair." Following his funeral services, and readers were told where and when the funeral would be held in case they wanted to attend it, Gore's body, they were told, was to be buried in, quote, "its final resting place in a little churchyard near the village." Death was, in the coverage, relief from a profane modern world, a comforting return to an uncomplicated pastoral landscape. Gore's lavish execution coverage was exceptional, but it brought together many of the melodramatic trappings that regularly appeared in newspapers' coverage of white men's executions during this period. An inquiry into the integrity of the self in the face of its annihilation, over-the-top language aimed at amplifying and elongating the emotionality of each moment, opportunities for sympathetic identification with the condemned on the part of readers, an idealization of the spiritual connection to family and a pastoral landscape that death could not sunder, and a non-classical narrative structure that circled back repeatedly to the moment of execution as if to milk its thrill value over and over and over again for readers. Over and over again in these stories, writers would test the theory that an execution was a moment of unraveling, a dissolution of the self, and an end to its capacity to exert mind over matter. Across the country, they studied the moods of condemned inmates in the days leading up to their execution to predict whether or not they would pass the ultimate test and face their moment of death with courage. They reveled in stories of courage mixed with vulnerability. In admiring coverage of James Satterfield, whose face appears in the upper left-hand corner, the Atlanta Constitution wrote in the present tense, taking readers with him on his march to the execution table, or eternity's reception hall, as the paper put it. Satterfield moved, quote, like a soldier on parade, chin up, back straight, hands swinging. On the execution platform, he transcended the oppressiveness of an atmosphere, quote, surcharged with horror, with nameless terror. As, quote, death the invisible glides in, and remember, this is written in the present tense, Satterfield's eyes, readers were told, seek the light of the window below him, and he looks beyond the preacher. There is just one ray of sunshine piercing into that gloomy death chamber, just one tiny ray, I'm reading this, right? that great world bathed in light and freedom, and that one ray holds Satterfield spellbound, right? The newspaper wrote. And you can see in this film that comes out in 1936, this kind of trope, this pattern of the condemned taking one last look at light before going into the execution chamber. So there's an intermixing between the journalistic coverage of actual executions and then this Hollywood portrayal of what they were all about. Contradictory imaginings of Satterfield as a causal agent and Satterfield as an object of divine grace mixed indistinguishably in this coverage. His, quote, mighty frame shakes with a few sobs as he spoke about his daughter in his very last moments. Yet somehow he was held to have, quote, met death unflinchingly without the slightest tremor, right? All in the same article. In the end, the Constitution told its readers triumphantly, Satterfield died not below the scaffold. He died on top there. The law did not kill him. He willed his own death. In that moment when he said, I am ready, the spirit was already taking flight from the body. Such reporting was integral to the plot arc of execution accounts, which often followed the narrative structure of what James L. Smith has called the melodrama of defeat. Whereas a prototypical melodrama ended with rescue, think of the woman who's saved at the last minute by the hero who's been chained to the train tracks by the villain, in melodramas of defeat, we found an important variant, right? One of the blameless hero whose fight against external forces is ultimately unsuccessful. He instead goes under, leaving the audience to pity his distresses or admire his fortitude with which he bears them. The heroes in execution stories were, of course, convicted felons, but the papers often, as I mentioned, downplayed the import of the crime that had led to their fate, summarizing it succinctly and unsentimentally. Indeed, these stories permitted readers to identify with the condemned, and in doing so, to manage their own anxieties as discrete objects buffeted about by a modern world that had been drained of both divine enchantment and patriarchal authority. And yet, as melodramas of defeat, such stories did not simply acknowledge that anxiety. When these execution stories were successful, the emotions they elicited affirmed the existence and the primacy of the very lifeblood that the modern world had threatened to drain from the body politic. The New York Herald Tribune reported that when Joseph Mulholland's mother tracked New York Governor Charles Whitman down in the lobby of the St. Regis Hotel and begged him on the day of his execution to spare his life, The governor's voice cracked with emotion as he spoke with her. He told her, quote, "The law must take its course," denying the very power that he did have to pardon the young man. After denying her plea, though, the paper reported, Governor Whitman eagerly, it said, granted her permission when she asked for it to visit her son one last time, a request that the authorities at Sing Sing Prison had initially denied to her. Here's a quote from the article. He asked if she had the money at hand for her railroad fare and seemed almost disappointed when she produced it. He was so anxious to do something to ease her pain. So I've argued so far that the popular image of capital punishment in newspapers in the 1910s, the 1920s, and the 1930s implicitly distanced the punishment from anxieties about a soulless and inhuman state. It raised those anxieties only to assuage them. Indeed, at times, these news stories stoked fantasies of emotional triumph over a modern world and a modern law that had been severed from traditional sources of meaning. Fictional representations of the death penalty could likewise portray the same kind of anxiety about modern life and the modern state. Most death penalty films between 1915 and 1940, about 83 of 133 that we looked at, depicted sympathetic white men who were unjustly sent to death row and saved at the last minute by a revelation of their innocence or by mitigating facts surrounding their crime, usually discovered and brought to the attention of a governor by a female family member or female romantic interest. The pattern first appeared in D.W. Griffith's Intolerance in 1916. In one of that film's three storylines, a young man attempting to go straight is sentenced to death for a murder he didn't commit in a case of mistaken identity. The film registered, as Larry May notes, the anxieties of the age. The young man and his pregnant wife had ended up in the city, right? They had been from rural America and they migrated to the city after a labor strike against an industrial capitalist had ruined their family, or their families financially. And after his conviction, elite progressives who all of a sudden they deem the wife an unfit mother and they use the power of the state to take the child from her care while her husband is on death row. And yet in a true melodramatic ending, innocence is vindicated. The wife gets a confession from the real murderer, secures a pardon from the governor, and then dashes to the prison with an army of friends arriving just in time to save her husband from the noose. The state might be growing more and more distant from the good, innocent rural citizen, the film admitted, but hope was not lost. Ultimately, through the governor's pardoning power, the state would still retain its democratic character and liberate rather than ensnare the belabored white citizen. Anxiety about circumstantial evidence was common in death penalty films. By the end of the long 19th century, migration patterns had concentrated thousands upon thousands of Americans in cities. The liberating anonymity of urban life, though, was also a potential liability. And death penalty films with mistaken identity themes expressed, in symbolic terms, the psychological costs of living in a city. A vast population could allow one to disappear from a constraining past, but it could also contain doppelgangers whose lawlessness might be fatal to one's future. Wrongful conviction on the basis of circumstantial evidence highlighted a different dark side to modern life. These films indicated the modern Sherlock Holmesian assumption that the truth of what happened at the scene of a crime could be reliably revealed by inductive reasoning. Cases logically built on circumstantial evidence got the condemned men, however, in these films into pickles, and it was women's moral intuition, a human response discounted in an age of rationalization, that was usually necessary to get the men out of these situations. Women did what the legal system, because of its objective detachment from context and its insistence on bureaucratic role norms and proper procedures, could not. Women could exonerate the innocent. And many of these films in this period end tellingly with a pardon from the governor. As the clock approaches execution time, as I discussed with Intolerance, proof of innocence is rushed to the prison, where upon its revelation, the execution is stopped and the condemned freed by an act of clemency. Justice audiences were reassured could be affected instantaneously and decisively, and the larger humanist values threatened by this modern legal system, like the idea that the innocent shouldn't be punished, right? Those ideas would not be replaced, audiences were assured, by an iron cage of legal procedure whose rigid faith in reason could make it insensitive to moral intuition. The modern state apparatus was legitimated in the end by an infusion of feminine intuition. So you can see here in Intolerance two screen captures. This is the three cords that are cut simultaneously by guards performing the execution, one of those cords opening the trap that will hang the condemned man, the other two being fakes, so that no one person bears responsibility for the killing, that it becomes the state, this abstract entity that's doing the killing. And we see in the shot just the hands, right? Because the sort of unique identity of these agents of the state don't matter. So we have this zoomed in shot, this moment of panic right before the woman runs in with the clemency proclamation from the governor. The woman had stopped the governor's train to get the, of course she stopped the governor's, they raced them in a car, right? These movies were about showing off what film could do. So they stop the train, and they get on board the train, and they make their case to the governor, but note who's sitting to the left of the governor. That's the governor's wife. And she puts her arm on him and insists, right, in the subtitles that he listen very carefully, and then he makes the right call. So you see this kind of infusion of a sort of feminine moral intuition against a cold, rational, the law must take its course kind of vision of the state. Sometimes in plays and film, condemned white men did die at the hands of the state. And in the creation of such narratives, writers generated a vision of the execution as a crucible that created martyrs and unsettled rather than recuperated law's legitimacy. Self-sacrifice was one of the more salient tropes that stage and screen audiences encountered in the 1920s and 1930s. True to melodrama's fantasies of morally pure innocence, writers portrayed condemned white men as martyrs to a set of traditional and endangered moral principles. The Valiant was a one-act play published in McClure's in 1921 and later made into a film in 1929, and it's an important example of this subgenre. On the eve of his execution, a mysterious man named James Dyke still won't tell anyone who he is, right? The name they know is not his real name. It's just the name he's been going by. Or why he shot a man to death and then immediately and honorably turned himself into the authorities. He merely explains to the warden of the prison, quote, "The man deserved to be killed. He wasn't fit to live. It was my duty to kill him, and I did it. I haven't any excuse. That is, I haven't any excuse that satisfies the law." As the clock ticks down to execution time, the warden delays the execution to allow a young man who has traveled to the urbanized East from, of course, bucolic Ohio, to visit the prison and find out if Dyke is her long-lost brother who disappeared over 10 years ago. Spoiler alert, he is. But he doesn't tell her. She arrives at the prison. She's this paragon of innocence, dressed all in white. The stage directions describe her as the quintessential melodramatic heroine. Quote, "Her manner betrays a certain spiritual aloofness from the ultra-modern world, a certain delicate reticence of the flesh, which immediately separates her from the metropolitan class. Her costume is not quite conservative enough to be literally old-fashioned, but it hints at the taste and repression of an old-fashioned home." In a meeting between the girl and Dyke, the audience realizes that he is, in fact, her brother, even as he successfully and honorably convinces that he is not. So anxious is he to protect and maintain her innocence. He tells her that though he is not her brother, he fought beside her brother during the war and saw him die a noble death. And he also bequeaths to her on her brother's behalf a significant sum of money. She leaves with the money and thinking that this stranger had known her brother and passed along an inheritance to her on his behalf, even though he didn't know she was coming to the prison on the day of his death. She leaves the prison. And the play ends with him repeating, as he's marched to the execution chamber, a line from Shakespeare's Julius Caesar, "The valiant never taste of death but once," right? I love doing this talk because I get to be a ham, because these texts are so hammy. The Valiant then showed how executions could become crucibles, tests of a man's capacity to stand for and protect in the face of enormous pressure, chivalrous duties that the law had usurped. The modern law had forbidden Dyke's vigilante enforcement of some masculine code of honor. We imagine that the shooting he did, would be thought justified. And it threatens to unman him by demanding his name and then besmirching it by publishing it to the public as someone who has been put to death by the state. The aptly named Dyke will not, in the end, though, let the law divert him from his chivalrous duty, nor will he permit his reputation to be sullied in the eyes of his female family members, even at the price of his own emotional comfort. To confirm his kinship to his sister would be to push her into the alienating, soulless, ultramodern world from which she has remained spiritually aloof. His valiant act, sacrificing his comfort for her innocence, posits capital punishment as a litmus test for the persistence of honor and courage in a world softened by commercialization, crass materialism, and cosmopolitan decadence. Echoing newspaper accounts of kindly state actors, representatives of the law are portrayed here as simultaneously enamored with Dyke and beholden to the law's soulless demand that he be put to death. While they ultimately do their duty and lead Dyke to his execution, the warden and the chaplain are visibly moved by his valiance, and they're racked by guilt, right? And these are lines that the pull quotes here are lines spoken by the warden and his lieutenant. There's something fine in a man who, facing death, can still be a good sportsman. Right? The warden says, "You've got to hand it to him," fights the priest, "Father. I never saw such nerve in all my life." Of course, he's trying to shield someone, right? So you get this kind of intensity of the respect that these people who are doing their duty and carrying out the execution have for this man who's being executed. While they ultimately do their duty and lead Dyke to his execution, they're visibly moved by him. They're racked by guilt. The film's press sheet, the ads for this film, when it came out, said, "A throbbing drama of the law, just, merciless, and cruel." And yet, one of the reviewers at the Production Code Administration, which was Hollywood's internally run censorship board at the time, loved the film precisely because it was different from the routine portrayal at the time of prison guards and prison personnel being these sadistic state actors. In his estimation, he wrote to a colleague in a memo, the film deserves salvos of applause. Quote, "It's a real picture, and it's interesting because there is no effort to save the man, no heroics about it. There's only a kindly sternness of the law, kindly sternness carried out by sympathetic, kindly officials," he wrote to colleagues. And as we saw in that example of Governor Whitman in New York, right, giving the money to the mother so she can go say goodbye, or wanting to her son, we saw this in representations of wardens who were often during this period very sort of open about their uncertainty about the death penalty. There was an article covered in the New York Times about Lorton Laws, the warden of Sing Sing, and how he and his wife put up the family in their own house, including the little children of a man who was being executed, and how the wife of the warden, on the eve of the execution, while the execution was happening, drove her around to try to get her mind off the execution, one of the headlines was, "Babes sleep tucked in warden's house as father put to death," right? So there are all these representations of state actors enacting this kindly sternness that is so prevalent in many of these martyr films that we see at the time. So the birth of film gave new opportunities to reinforce capital punishment as an institution that was becoming modernized and had the potential to become machine-like and horrifying, but whose annihilating power was ultimately checked by democratic triumph in stories that ended with a pardon, and existential triumph in those stories that ended with an execution. The shots of ticking clocks that these films often showed were likely designed to enhance their thrill factor, but they also implicitly communicated the fact that an execution was governed by rules that forbade the use of lethal violence before an appointed time. That waiting time became a tool that journalists and cultural producers used to humanize the administration of the death penalty in America's popular imagination. In films that ended in exoneration or commutation, time gave the family members, especially those female family members and friends, the opportunity to remedy a potential injustice. Audiences saw that white men would be the beneficiaries of discretion that were vested in good state actors who would be responsive to proof of innocence, and whose intuition and paternalistic goodness was a crucial bulwark against the soullessness of a legal, rational political order. In plots that ended with execution, time did something different. It gave journalists and fiction writers a way to develop stories of spiritual triumph over a profane world that ultimately softened the violence and annihilated the horror of state killing. As states in the 1930s completed a century-long transition from public spectacle-like executions to private, technocratic, administrative ones, journalists and authors created depictions of capital punishment that were the only way most Americans would have access to knowledge about what was happening inside their nation's death chambers. In this new, highly mediated context, Americans found a racial image of the death penalty that was at stark odds with its material reality. It's not difficult to speculate why fictional or actual white executions got so much more attention from journalists and fiction writers. Newspapers, Broadway plays, mass-marketed films, and short fiction, all of these things were aimed at white audiences, and they, of course, used white characters to create a point of entry for the imagined audience, who would be thought unable to relate to a character of color. But while the motivations underlying the presentation of a racially distorted vision of capital punishment might be pretty straightforward, I think its consequences have been profound. We've created a large body of folk knowledge about what it means to die at the hands of the state, centered around the experiences of white men. In the 1990s, as the number of annual executions grew rapidly with each passing year, a spate of new death penalty films, drawing upon patterns developed in these early 20th century films and news stories, showed white men, and in fact, there was one film that showed a white woman, finding previously unrecognized goodness in themselves before enduring execution. Like the narratives of self-sacrifice that audiences encountered in the 1920s and 1930s, these films presented condemned inmates whose death generated pathos, generated sympathy. But unlike their melodramatic predecessors, films in the 1990s made no effort to minimize or justify the crimes of the condemned killer in order to make them sympathetic. No, the condemned in the 1990s were no longer embodiments of public anxieties about the soulless misuse of government power or human vulnerability in a newly modernized world. They were instead the protagonists in private tales of redemption, in which the state's violence did what rehabilitation programs could not, by jump-starting with a death sentence a process of moral and spiritual regeneration. The pathos generated at the end of these films was pity not for the condemned person's plight, but for a past in which they were held hostage by their own hateful and destructive view of the world, which we see melt away from them as the clock ticks towards the hour of their execution. Their punishments were not occasions for martyring the self to traditional values, or they weren't testaments to the ongoing value of individual life in an age of its spiritual annihilation. They were instead portrayed as the ultimate catalyst for positive internal change. In the tough love that capital punishment offered condemned inmates in the films of the 1990s, we can hear echoes of the sternly kindness that made The Valiant so compelling for the Hollywood censor who wrote in the 1920s. That legacy may help us to understand the meaning of this punishment in a country that locks up 1% of its adult population, leading the world in incarceration. In some provocative accounts of the role that criminal punishment has played in the recent history of the United States, criminal justice policy has been cast as a mechanism for maintaining the subordination of non-white people to the benefit of whites. Many scholars have argued that mass incarceration has done what slavery, Jim Crow, and the urban ghetto did in earlier periods. It has separated black bodies from white bodies while exploiting black labor. And disproportionately used against those convicted of killing white people, the death penalty today has continued to reflect and reinforce, albeit in a more indirect way, racial hierarchy in the United States. But that material reality has been masked then and now by a cultural life of punishment that has received comparatively less attention. That our narratives of punishment in its most extreme form have, since the early 20th century, focused on the experiences of sympathetic white men should call our attention to the way that punishment in the United States has functioned as a symbol of dignity as well as degradation. Harsh punishment, these texts remind us, has not only been a mechanism for maintaining non-white subordination, it has also been imagined as a mechanism that expresses, as conservative pro-death penalty scholar Walter Burns wrote in the late 1970s, it helps us to imagine punishment as a mechanism that reinforces that element of the soul, and here I'm quoting him, that is connected with the view that there is responsibility in the world, and that in holding particular men responsible, it pays them the respect which is due them as men. In recognizing the gap between capital punishment's symbolic life and its material effects, we might begin to conceive of the death penalty as a practice that has long gained legitimacy in the United States by appealing to our positive values as well as our repressive desires. Thank you.
I'm a historian and of a slightly earlier period than Daniel, and so Jessica invited me just to come and give what I could of a little bit of a sort of prehistoric kind of context to the story that Daniel tells about the late 19th and early 20th centuries and beyond. For some context, I suppose I should say that in North Carolina, for example, after the Civil War, we have a mandatory death sentence for four crimes, murder, rape, burglary, and arson. If you are convicted of these crimes, you receive a death sentence. And that complicates things right away, because one of the greatest challenges of the death penalty is that actually inflicting it on everyone who gets sentenced would be untenable, and we would have to get rid of it altogether. So we develop a number of mechanisms that we use in order not only to make the infliction of the death sentence tolerable, but also to make sure that people who are sentenced to death don't actually die. And this is a history that continues to this day. Daniel talked about lots of important things, but about two things in particular that struck me. One was about anxiety and the sort of the cultural anxieties of the time that drove understandings, cultural anxieties about modernity that drove understandings about the death penalty. I'd like to address a little bit of the same question of anxiety in a slightly different context. That is to say, the anxieties about barbarism that people in the 19th century and early 20th century had about the infliction of capital punishment. They were less anxious about modernity than seeing modernity as a way to save us, we being North Carolinians or Southerners or punishers generally, from the brutal infliction of punishment. And these the electrocution and the gas chamber are two ways to sort of save us from that barbarity. And Daniel also mentioned entertainment, these films that showed us compelling narratives about people who were on their way to the death chamber. Before this period of film, of course, we had actual executions as entertainment. They were what was entertaining, and that was what concerned people, what made elites anxious, that the spectacle of death was barbarous, and to treat an execution like a carnival show was barbarous, and we must make it private. So I want to begin with an example of a hanging that went really well, I think, for everyone involved. There's an African-American man named Stephen Richardson in Wilmington in 1880, June 1880, and he's been sentenced to death for the murder of what the newspapers describe as an old white man. He is praying audibly in his prison cell while the scaffold is being constructed in the jail yard outside, and the reporter can hear him through the window praying. He's been baptized the night before, and he's telling the people that he's praying with that he would be disappointed if his hanging was put off somehow, because he's ready. He's spiritually prepared to go, and he's ready to die. He walks unassisted the next morning, or I should say it's about noon. He walks unassisted to this newly constructed scaffold with ministers who are praying with him. He ascends and addresses the audience. It's been announced that this execution is going to be private. Nevertheless, 2,000 people show up and gather around in this sort of not at all private setting, because no actual effort has been made to make it private, and they listen to him speak. He talks at length. He prays publicly. He speaks to people directly in the audience, making eye contact with them and talking to them, recognizing them and calling them by their names. Ministers, officials, the jury joins him on the scaffold and stand with him, sort of witnessing his penitence. He tells people there, don't do what I did, the classic avoid whiskey and women. He tells people that he is saved and that he's ready to move on. He chooses hymns that he sings with the crowd, and people sing, and there's a call and response. He takes on this remarkable leadership role that you would think would be fairly uncommon for a poor, uneducated African-American person in the Jim Crow South. And when he dies, he goes willingly. And the only problem that happens is as he is falling through the trap, the mechanism that drops out under the feet once the noose has been placed over the head and the black cap has been placed over the face, is that someone who apparently didn't notice what was going on walks by, and he sort of drops and hits the guy's shoulder. And that causes a little bit of consternation. But he dies well, the newspaper says. He dies quickly. There's no struggling. His head is not separated from his body. His feet do not hit the ground. These are problems that people do encounter in hangings. And his mother is in attendance to take him away in a coffin and bury him in a place of her choosing. So according to the narrative of people who were constructing punishment at the time, that went great. He was reintegrated into the community. He managed to pray. He took responsibility for his actions. The state was happy because everything went well. The sheriff was happy because everything went well. And Stephen Richardson accepted his fate. and died with the degree of comfort that all of us perhaps would want in our own dying moments. So this is an example of the death penalty really kind of functioning properly. But outside of that proper function is this whole other set of anxieties that sheriffs and others would have confronted in actually having to construct, for instance, a scaffold and do a hanging. If you're a sheriff in one of North Carolina's counties, we don't have enough executions to actually mean that you're likely to do more than one in your lifetime or in your period of service as sheriff. So you get a note saying that you need to figure out how to tie a noose, and you need to learn how to build a scaffold, and you need to figure out how to kill someone efficiently and effectively and in a way that won't harm them. The anxiety that provoked for these sheriffs, even white sheriffs in a racially segregated, racially subjugatory Jim Crow context, was profound to the extent that sheriffs shared nooses that had been proven successful, writing to one another, asking for a noose that worked to be sent in the mail to them to use in their own execution. I don't have to tell you that using a noose put strain on the rope and therefore might actually increase the risk of what was called bungling and what still is. Sheriffs would weave ropes out of fishing line. There were all sorts of plans devised. The New York plan had a system of pulley weights that would be dropped and fling a body upward with enough force to kill quickly. This sort of technological contortions that sheriffs and sometimes paid executioners went through in order to make sure that they were executing in a way that reflected the nobility and dignity of the state as they understood it were fairly profound. And that anxiety reflects a kind of sense of instability and insecurity about the execution process generally that moves us towards a period of needing or feeling that we need an execution chair in a private chamber. Thousands and thousands and thousands of people gathered at executions, public executions in North Carolina and across the South. 10,000 people gather in an 1890 execution in Hillsborough to watch three burglars hang, right? Mandatory death sentence for burglary. 2,000 people showed up to Stephen Richardson's execution. People come travel from all over the state. They bring food, they bring liquor, they bring their children. There's a carnival atmosphere. A woman named Mary Gash, who attended an execution that probably took place in Elizabeth City, although we're not certain, in 1831, wrote to her sister. She wrote a two-page letter about the execution. One page was about all the rowdy boys there who made uninterrupted eye contact with her and made her uncomfortable because she didn't have a male escort, and the other page was about the hanging itself. So the atmosphere of these events was riotous, and it really worried people, the kinds of people who wrote for and read newspapers, that this was not the kind of presentation that the state needed to put forward. Crucially also, these were often interracial crowds. And like Stephen Richardson, most of the people who were executed were black. And the idea of putting forward an African-American person as a spiritually whole, fully functional member of a community where they were being denied a host of other rights sent a very complicated message to people who were expected to be wholeheartedly participating in a culture of subjugation. Moreover, the liquor would lead to fights and a general unruliness and drunkenness, fights on the train in the roads on the way in and out, and there would be squabbles sometimes over the material of the execution itself. The body would be removed, and a fight might break out over the rope, which would be cut into pieces and divided among people who would take it home for souvenirs. When the scaffold was deconstructed, having been built for the first time, people would seek to take home wooden planks and boards. All this seemed very unseemly. And the move inside in North Carolina happens in 1910 when we build a private electrocution chamber where we put an electric chair. The electric chair is actually still in Raleigh. It's just in the basement of the State Museum there. I don't think you can see it anymore, but it used to be on display. This move to sort of make more efficient and to use what was called the sort of magical genie of electricity to instantaneously and painlessly kill criminals is an absolute and utter failure. And we actually move from kind of a triumph of efficiently administered hanging in the 1880s to torturous hangings with bodies bursting into flame, with people crowding into the electrocution chamber, which is still not at all private, straining up against the metal chain that divides you from the person in the chair, who's as far as this woman it might be from me, sweat running down your face in Raleigh in July, the stench of burning flesh, and people passing out and fainting in the death chamber and not being able to fall to the ground because they're so crowded in with other people who are gathering to watch. So making the executions private certainly did not reflect a lack of interest among the public, and it certainly didn't reflect an increase in the dignity of the condemned persons or those involved. What it did do, however, was bring execution well within the boundaries of a racist Jim Crow North Carolina in the early 1900s, which is seeking increasingly to exclude African Americans from sites of public gathering, including the electrocution chamber and then including the gas chamber, both in Raleigh. And this rigidity that slowly enforces itself increasingly excluding members of the community from participation in the death penalty process is, I think, a contributing factor to the narrative that Daniel lays out about the expressivity of death happening only and increasingly through popular culture. And we see that happening in particular in my own research in the News and Observer, which goes from a circulation of 15,000 in 1915 to 120,000 in 1950, reaching vast new audiences to describe with the kind of florid detail and the kind of racialized detail the torturous killings of mainly of African-American, young African-American men. So I think that very sort of short history of moving quickly from hanging to electrocution, we move to the gas chamber. Each move is attended by errors, by pain, and by difficulty. Is not at all unfamiliar to people who are working in death penalty studies or reading about the death penalty today, when we are using mysterious forces, drugs that we don't know the name of or don't have to reveal the name of, to be injected by professionals or non-professionals into people in mixtures that are also remain private, and as we've seen recently, can be painful and lead to uncertain outcomes. So I think what we're looking at here is not at all a history of progress, which is what we want to sort of embrace to an extent in our national self-definition, but a history of stagnation and struggle, and really a history that remains unresolved and remarkably static. So I'll leave it at that for now, and more gory details later, perhaps. Thanks.
I'm Jen Vitry. How are you guys doing? I'm a little unsettled by what I just saw that these guys put on. How do you guys feel?
Oh. I work with clients in death row, and I'm really unsettled right now, just watching, listening to the research that's
put on here about what society expects and what society doesn't take accountability for. I'm going to talk a little bit about my personal experience, and I'm going to open it up to questions. I'm not going to stay long. My stomach is a little turned by this. But the first time I went to Angola, probably about 15 years ago, I remember going with my then boss, Denny LaBeouf. She's a remarkable death penalty warrior. Some of you know her. I was, you know, going to Angola. Angola's the farm. It's an ex-plantation, 5,000 prisoners. It's an eerie place. I've come to embrace it because I go there a lot. But the stretch, it's an old plantation. It's named Angola because the slaves were from Angola. And it was a plantation. And it's still a plantation. But now it's called a prison. I will say, coming back from death row, probably a year ago, death row used to be in the front. Now it's way in the back. You have to drive for a while. You got to pull over, get your car inspected, pat you down, go in. I feel a little bit better when I'm in the car because I know I can maybe get out, storm the gates. It's when I get out of the car and go into the prison, main population or a camp or death row, I start to get really nervous and panicky. Like, oh, they shut the first door. I walk up the stairs. They shut the second door. I go through another metal detector. They pat me down. They check my supplies, chat me up. I remember you. You work for that Capitol office. I've become friends with them now, so they're not as aggressive with me anymore. But I start to feel a little bit violated. I'm behind two sets of bars. I'm locked in. It's going to take a long time for me to get out. If they decide they want to mess with me, they can. They flip my belongings. You know, even when they're nice, it feels really aggressive. Then I go through another set of doors up a stairs. They lock the doors are locked. I'm in a stairwell. I gotta wait till that door shuts. Another guard comes through the window, lets me out through that door. That stairwell sometimes is a long time. I get out of there, and this is, you know, the early days in the old death row. They open another metal door for you, and you're on a long stretch, and there's metal seats, and there's a bunch of windows, and they all have these metal mesh. Your client comes in, they tell you to have a seat. That experience I had from the beginning to the end of meeting my client, I feel really upset. And I don't even live here. I just visit. You know, I sit down, I'm happy to see my client. My client walks out, he sits on the other side of the mesh, you know, white shirt. They take the shackles, they shackle him in. He can't move his feet too much. Sometimes they let his arm go only if he has to sign documents, but otherwise those are handcuffed as well, sits down on a metal seat across from me. Now, of course, the metal seat that's part of the floor is not even. So he either has to stand to see me or look at me like this, which after an hour is really going to be a lot of fun, you know, for him. So he ends up having to stand there leaning over with, you know, shackles on. After about, you know, an hour, my eyes start to go a little funny. I have to keep moving and look at him because the metal mesh is really messing with my eyes. There's these canisters for cigarettes. Back then we used to smoke. You know, sometimes my client would smoke and the big coffee cans would sit there. And I mean, that's all you really did, you know, as you're talking about the case and things get more and more unsettled, you know, you smoke cigarettes. And then sometimes they'll, you know, let me see another client or another client and then I leave. When I was first there, though, when I first went to death row, I remember Denny walking us up, and it was the death row was in the front. And, you know, you brought up civility and culture, and as you park and you walk in, you get, you know, patted down, all the usual stuff. I remember us walking down the walkway, and this beautiful fountain on the right-hand side, and you could see the windows and the bars where I hadn't been there yet, so I'm imagining the death row inmates are looking out at us. And we had to stop because there was a mama duck and baby ducks that had to walk across the walkway to get to the other pond. And I'm really like, what the fuck is this? I'm on death row, and you know, I'm going to death row, but I got to stop to let these beautiful ducks cross the path, you know, in the fountain and the big, you know, beautiful red decoration. It's like, what is happening here? I'm like, is this, you know, I asked Denny, is this, she's like, oh yeah, this is how it is here. They decorate, you know, the next time I went, there was Easter decorations, and there was, like, Christmas decorations, and there's a whole culture here, and the people on the farm, they live there, you know, generation after generation after generation. This is their world. This is their life. They don't know, and some of them are really nice to the inmates, you know. Some of them really care. Years and years ago, I mean, you can do a lot of reading about 70s Angola bloodbath. I'm not going to sit here and rag on all the guards at Angola because they're part of the, you know, world there too, and this is their world. But the reality is, they act like it's cool. They act like it's okay. They act like nothing's wrong. There's ducks, there's a pond. There's something very wrong. I'll tell you that the first thing that bothered me was all the forensic evidence in the case. You know, opening up a case file from the 80s and saying, wait a minute, you know, lectured this morning, I showed them pictures. Wait, here's a gun, and when I went and looked at the evidence and pulled it out of the bag, the hammer is missing from the gun. I mean, you guys saw pictures of that, so you know I'm not lying. How is this guy on death row when this is the murder weapon and the hammer is missing from the gun? So, of course, we have the gun tested, never been used, broken gun, but there's gun and bullets, and that's what they showed the jury. Okay, so, well, that's a problem in that case. Surely every other case is not like this. Case after case after case that I opened, here's one snitch. Oh, well, I look in the back of this, you know, this snitch's file. Suddenly, this guy has been a snitch for 7 other cases. You know, his criminal rap sheet was 4 times as long as my client's. My client committed 1 robbery. But he pointed him out, he testified against him, and it was 1993, and that's all you needed. So when we present evidence and say, well, he's a snitch, and he wasn't even there at the time, we actually have witnesses who say that he was down the street at a poker game. Well, I don't know, is that appeal expired? Do you have the right? Did you already preserve that on appeal? Do you have an actual innocence claim? Because, you know, these are the legal bars are in front of you. Unless you can file it under some claim in PCR or something's already been preserved, nobody cares. Nobody cares that guy was not the real eyewitness. So but he's on death row. I'm like, but wait, we're going to kill him. We're going to kill him. So obviously we should have more evidence than some eyewitness who is not an eyewitness who's a snitch. Okay, so then I find another case, and another case, another case. I was really compelled by how much evidence is missing. You know, how many times I open up a file and I'm like, okay, well, Denny would say, let's go see the evidence. Oh, well, let's go see the evidence. Shouldn't be a problem, right? The guy's on death row. We're in post-conviction, so he just lost his appeals. He just lost his trial. I should be able to go find the evidence. Surely we preserve the evidence for a guy we're going to kill. Oh, St. Mary Parish. Oh, well, honey, I got to call the sheriff. I think it was in his garage. Hold on, so I get there. Hey, hold on, darling. You're not representing that guy? Oh, he's an asshole. Don't worry. We got him locked up. I'm like, I know. That's who I work for, that guy, that asshole. Oh, honey, well, you don't really need to look at that stuff. I really need to look at that stuff. Can we go look for it? We go look in his garage. Another case, the DA investigator who's no longer at the DA's office, we go search his attic. Because he left the DA's office, but he took that file with him. Where's their chain of custody? Oh, here's Here's a gun, here's a shoe, here's a hat. Well, we want to test this evidence, but now there's no chain of custody. So how are we? So this is what really got me into this work. But what really kept me in this work is mitigation. So I started being really pissed off, but I went to this hearing, one of my earlier hearings. I don't want to say clients' names because it's inappropriate, probably as much as I'm saying now is inappropriate, but because I'm active on cases. We're sitting in front of the judge, having the hearing, really intense experience. I learned later that this client has organic brain damage, really chronic abuse from childhood. I didn't know what any of that meant at the time. I'm not a psychologist, how would I know? And during the hearing, I felt really bad for our client, naturally, and I'm trying to bond with him. So, you know, I pat him on the shoulder, like, buddy, it's gonna be all right. And then I did it again, we went on break. Buddy, it's gonna be again. He turns around, he looks at me, he's like, can you stop patting me on the head like a dog? And I was like, oh my God, I've failed. What I realized is, I don't have a bridge with you. I'm a person with resources. I'm middle class. I'm white. Like, I don't know anything about what your experience is. And you know what I did? I went to the file. I started reading the mitigation file. Marie Campbell, an amazing mitigation specialist and a mentor of mine. She did this beautiful workup. I learned what mitigation was. In there, I read a story of his life. I read about his mom, who left him and his brother and sister, often would just walk out of the screen door, lock the screen door from the outside, and go drink two fifths of bourbon. He was two. The neighbors would talk about how they would go in and they would bust in the door and get in there to go feed them, to go change them. Dirty diapers, dogs, all kinds of stuff on the floor. That's just one thing. His mom eventually moved to California and was murdered. And then he was inherited by his father, and he was his step kid, and what he did was take care of his brothers and sisters. Literally was their servant, like would take care of them. There are more stories and more stories. And also, when we did a brain scan, there's a piece of this guy's brain missing, like literally. He has organic brain damage. His mom drank, you know, excessively while he was a kid. So I'm learning all this stuff, but I'm like, what do I do with all this? Like, where do I put all this? But what it made me realize is I have no idea who he is. I can't see through his eyes. I don't know how he sees the world, how he interacts with the world. These are signs and symptoms that I'm watching these signs and symptoms develop in him through this work, you know, through the documents, through the witnesses, through the interviews of who he was. And I'm realizing he's very different than me. He doesn't see the world the way I do. He doesn't function the world the way I do. And he ended up in that homicide, in that incident, in whichever capacity he was in, because he's not like me, because his psychiatric picture is so compromised at this stage that he doesn't function like a normal individual. How did he get there? Is he evil? Is he bad? This is the kind of stuff I hear from prosecutor. I'll tell you what I want to know is, how did he get there? Because I know there's a horrible tragedy that we have to talk about. And I'll tell you what I want to do is I want to understand it. And I want to say the death penalty is not a deterrent. We need to intervene a long time before then. You can't just kill your mentally ill and broken and think that's a sound decision. We're a civilized community. Let's be civil. Let's think about if we need to heal and we need to grow and we want to understand, let's start with these heinous crimes. Let's look at what happened to this individual, that he ended up in this situation, whether he's the most culpable or not. You know, whether there is a snitch line or not, none of my guys on death row are there for no reason. My client, Damon Thibodeau, 15 years, innocent, death row, exonerated, walked out. He still was there for a reason. He still has a story about his life that made him really unable to let those police officers push him into a false confession. He provided a false confession. I love false confession cases. I'll take them all the time. You got one, call me. Hopefully you guys don't have one, but you know about one, call me. False confession cases are really interesting, you know? I don't want to take up too much more time, but I'm just going to say that mitigation, what we do in these cases is we go in, and we tell a story about the client's life. And it's not just why they're important. It's who they are. It's a multi-generational history. Who are their mothers? Who are their grandmothers? Who are their, you know, what do their mothers and grandmothers do? What do their mothers and grandmothers teach them? I talked to a class this morning, and we talked about my client Jimmy and his mother who was deaf and how she couldn't speak and the trauma that she endured, and how her mother kept her in a home, her own home, because she was the product of rape. Mother was embarrassed of her. Didn't let her out of the house. She couldn't speak. She had her own way of speaking. She didn't know how to really communicate. This is my client grew up in that house. When he went to school, he had to get speech treatment, a speech pathologist, who ultimately testified for him. So we do a multi-generational social history. We call it a biopsychosocial history. We get all the documents from their youth. We get mama's birth records. We figure out what was going on when they were born. We figure out what was going on when they were a young adult. And I'm just going to tell you, it's really sad to pick up a document. Here's a case in Ohio. I have 3,000 pages of OCS records. I'm not kidding you. 3,000 pages of a guy that they want to kill, of instances of OCS workers going to the house and saying it's uninhabitable. We have to send in a cleaning team from the paid by the state so these people can function. The cleaning team goes to the house and leaves and says, we can't work with this. It's too much. Left the kid in the house. Police officers go to arrest daddy because he's threatened to kill the neighbors with guns. They calm him down, but they tell, you know, my client, go back in the house. They don't remove the kid. Mama disappears for 4 days. Kids aren't in school. They go, they come home. Six kids in the house. No adults. No school. No nothing. Where are the adults? Well, mama was comatose for 2 days and in a depressive cycle, and she never did come home. Daddy was drunk. Didn't take the kid out of the house. I have to go to a hearing in February to see whether or not he has to die. We have to put on a mitigation hearing to say, why is it compelling enough, these 3,000 pages of OCS records? Well, you didn't intervene. Where's our accountability? Who needs to intervene? I don't know. Teachers, social workers, the state, us, everyone. Otherwise, what's going to happen to this guy? Do you think he's not going to become so dysfunctional and self-medicate and unhealed and no treatment and no resources that he's going to kill someone? Yes. That's going to happen. So social history is where it's at. And also, if you're a teacher, document for me, please, for us. You know, if you're a social worker, document. Find a pen pal. Our guys are really lonely, and they would love to talk to you. Not about their case. Please don't correspond with them about their case. Correspond with them about what they like. They like sailboats. They painting. They're human beings. They want to talk to you. And a lot of them are on there for things that you would laugh at their case. You'd say, I can't even believe that guy's in death row. But he is. And there are people who are fighting to get him off. But meanwhile, he needs somebody to talk to. So that was a lot. But let's be accountable together. Let's have this conversation, which is really powerful. Let's continue thinking about how to grow and heal as a civilized community and stop killing people. Thanks.
Thank you, everyone. I'll throw out the first question here and then we'll open it up. You all told really amazing, compelling stories about stories, which I see as the strongest connection here between all of this. And it's so amazing and fascinating to think about the difference between what Jen is painting here as the stories that you read in files that you compile through various state-based and mitigation specialist sources versus the stories that are viewed for entertainment through Hollywood, through journalism sometimes, and of course, what interests people. And I think, Jen, you said it best when you said, these stories that I read are so depressing, they're so sad, right? Nobody really wants to be entertained by that, right? So I guess I just want you all, if you can, or whoever wants to, comment on this sort of question of public interest in what's happening, how that the state does or doesn't react to public interest and perception of what is happening on death row, whether through Hollywood or through reality. That's it.
Do you want to go? I think, one of the struggles that I think are presented to folks who are committed to abolishing the death penalty is that in some ways, I think the biggest enemy of capital punishment in the United States is narrative. It's narratives like the ones I spoke about that present what happens in an execution chamber as an act of satisfying retribution. And I think that those narratives are compelling to people who are both for the death penalty and against the death penalty. And I think it puts those of us who oppose the death penalty into a bind, because what I think is ultimately leading to the demise of the death penalty in the United States is an increasing awareness of its meaninglessness. Executions happen on average 16 and a half years after conviction. They happen to fewer than 15% of people who are sentenced to death actually end up executed. The vast majority of people we sentence to death don't undergo execution in the United States. And I think there's a sort of disillusionment that's happening, and I think that culture reverses that disillusionment. Cultural stories of redemption, cultural stories of a person undergoing amazing spiritual growth, and then facing their death in all sorts of different ways. You know, the Texas website posts the last statements of every person they put to death, all 500 plus of them since 1977. And those statements reveal a wide variety of unique individuals who are making a kind of claim for themselves at that moment of death. And as a humanist, as someone committed to humanist principles, I think it's important for us to recognize that the horror of capital punishment is in the denial of humanity that's inherent in the act of executing someone. As sort of someone who's shrewdly politically aware of the fact that retribution doesn't happen unless the person who's put to death is seen as a human being in that moment of punishment, I worry that these narratives provide satisfaction to the 60% of Americans who say that they are in favor of the death penalty. Whether the person comes off as defiant or sympathetic, what is kept in our mind, at the forefront of our mind, is that an execution is a punishment, when in reality, it happens to people who have been institutionalized, who have been worn down, 11% of whom volunteer for execution because they feel as if their humanity has been taken from them by the state long before they're actually brought into an execution chamber. So I think it's a really double-edged sword telling stories about people on death row. It's important for those of us who are abolitionists to remind ourselves what we're fighting for. On the other hand, I think that it sometimes ultimately reinforces a romantic view of punishment as a moral reckoning, even when we all know that it can't be that. So I think thinking about audience when we think about narrative, particularly in the abolitionist community, is something that's really difficult and hard to do. How do we not deny the humanity of the people who are on death row while at the same time not feeding narratives of redemption that ultimately serve to satisfy a curious public's ideas about what an execution is all about?
You're smart. I like this guy. Well said. He addressed it so well, I will only say, we know it's not a deterrent. We know it doesn't fix anything. We know it's too costly. We know it's a problem. I've worked with victims, family members, we call it defense-initiated victim outreach, DEVO work. It's complicated. And what we've learned, I say we as a community, is that, and this I'm going off from your narrative, but I know you're looking at me, but we've learned that they are mistreated by the system as well, that what they're looking to heal from is never addressed, and that they often feel manipulated by the system, used, and a number of times that we've reached out to them, we have worked together to try and achieve a life plea, because they don't, often they aren't looking for this. It's fueled a lot by the prosecution. I can't say that across the board, but that's my experience with it, is that there's a disconnect, is my answer. There's a disconnect as a society with the process and the actual prosecution. I think in the class today, a lot of people were really astonished when I started giving examples of what actually happens in cases, because people just don't know. Surely they're on death row, they did something. Yeah, they did a robbery when they were 18. Not this, though, or not this way, or this, but let's talk about them. So there's a disconnect with how involved we want to be as a society. There's a disconnect with what we're committed to for the victim's family. What are their rights? How are they treated with the prosecution? And how we attend to everyone in this situation with a thought of healing.
Yeah, I mean, I'll just add sort of, as we sort of sit and ponder the death penalty in this moment, when it appears to be kind of diminishing in some ways from public view and from wide use, in part, at least I think that because of the sense of actual innocence in the work of people like Jen and exonerations, which demonstrate to people that you might actually end up in a death chamber having not done anything. We can all imagine being innocent, because at least for the moment we are. It's much harder to imagine being guilty of the kind of serious crime that we expect would land us on death row. There's sort of an irony in the resurgence of the death penalty in the modern period, because at least in North Carolina, I mentioned that we had this mandatory death penalty for most of the 20th century. Well, starting in 1941, we start chipping away at it, and we make the death penalty for burglary and arson is no longer mandatory. In 1949, it's no longer mandatory for murder and for rape. In 1953, we allowed anyone who is death eligible, anyone who's going to go on trial for their life, to sort of choose themselves to do what we would call kind of pleading out now, just to take a life sentence in exchange for avoiding a death sentence. So as a state, North Carolina, and this is pre-civil rights movement North Carolina, this is Jim Crow North Carolina, is actively putting barriers between execution and the people who are being sentenced to death, signaling a real discomfort with the death penalty and a lack of interest in the death penalty as a functional criminal justice tool. And North Carolina stops executing people in 1961, not because the state is no longer able to, but because no one's getting sentenced to death anymore. Juries just aren't doing it. People aren't up for the death penalty. And we don't execute people for 20 years. We have a 20-year moratorium. And we only start executing again after the Supreme Court intervenes and says execution is so rare in the United States that it's cruel and unusual and violates the Eighth Amendment. The Supreme Court basically reprimands the United States for not executing enough, despite the fact that the death penalty is on the books. And then states start scrambling to rewrite their statutes. And we have in 1977 the Supreme Court validating those rewritten statutes and saying, okay, you can start executing again. And even then it takes 4 years for North Carolina to start again. There's something very strange there, and in a way kind of ahistoric, about the resurgence of the death penalty since the 1970s. And its diminution over time between the end of the Civil War and the 1980s in North Carolina.
Thank you so much. Just real quick, from your experiences, what are the practical points of leverage that we can exert in terms of advocacy to push back against the death penalty? What angles should we be working? How do we recruit? What do we say? What tactics, basic social organizing tactics, have effectiveness? I'm open to all suggestions.
I think one of the most compelling things that can be said now is the damage that the death penalty is doing for the family members of homicide victims. There's research that came out of the University of Texas that shows that families in Minnesota, which doesn't have a death penalty, which has life without parole, researchers tracked the family members of homicide victims in Minnesota for whom their beloved one's killer had gotten life. And then they followed the experiences of families in Texas whose beloved one's killer had gotten a death sentence. And what they found is because of, you know, in Texas, the average time between sentencing and execution is 12 years. When Carol Chessman was executed by the state of California in 1960, he had survived for 12 years. That was seen as amazing. No one lasted on death row for 12 years. Now, 12 years is below average. And so what ends up happening is that these families are put through the pain of reliving this experience with every court hearing, with every reversal, with every retrial. Whereas in states like Minnesota, the families are able to move on by so many different measures of psychological health.
So the uncertainty that's built into the death penalty and the way that it's practiced today, I think we have to convince people that that uncertainty cannot be resolved. It cannot be legislated away. We tried in the 1990s to reduce the time between sentencing and execution. It only has doubled since then, right, nationally. And so I think that what we need to emphasize is that the system is slow, and that slowness is born, the pain of that slowness is born by the victims in whose name so often the death penalty is requested.
Well, and also, I mean, and another, I mean, this is a shift that emerged in your talk, Daniel, where you talked a lot, you were quoting newspapers and movies as saying that the death penalty was about paying a debt to society. And we don't talk about that as much anymore. That appears throughout the early 20th century in newspaper coverage. We talk about closure, this fairly recent invention that the families of victims of crime need closure, and it's a personal sort of experience for them. And so I think that bears very strongly on what you just had to say. From the historical perspective, I would simply say that the death penalty was by and large a punishment that was used to enforce racial slavery. It was essential, slave owners believed, to keep order on their plantation. And it was written into North Carolina law that slaves should be executed publicly and brutally. And that tradition carried on into the Jim Crow South, when the vast majority of people executed in North Carolina by hanging, by electrocution, by asphyxiation, were African-American men who killed white victims. And it was such a racialized punishment that a white murderer who in 1911 was on his way to the electric chair cut his own throat because he said he would not be the first white man electrocuted in North Carolina. People knew it, and that the truth of its sort of deep racial character continued until this last execution I mentioned in 1961. And so to my mind, it's indefensible for us to continue to perpetuate an institution that was explicitly written into our laws as a way of maintaining enslavement.
There's some really practical things. I'm just going to address it that way. There's you can write to your governor. You can, when you read about it in the paper, that there's an upcoming execution, you can write to people. You can write to the judge. You can write to the governor. You can say, I oppose this. I live here. I don't like this anymore. Be honest, be real, and say what you feel. Like, maybe you don't know a lot about the case. Maybe you just don't want this to happen anymore. Maybe you read something about the case, and you're you know, curious if this person did it or that person did it, but there's too many questions, or it's a broken system, or an innocent person has been executed, and we know that now. There is an organization called Grace in Texas. You can send a check to Dana Lynn's organization. She's still training mitigation specialists and forensic investigators and taking on a hell of a workload. You can organize yourselves. There's a state post-conviction office or appellate group in every state almost now, in every state, working, representing guys on death row. You can ask how you can volunteer. Maybe I can make some copies. And you can show up to rallies or get an abolition list. I think Sister Helen's organization still has a moratorium campaign that you can sign. And let's just continue this conversation.
Thanks for your excellent talks. Really, really powerful. I have a question that's sort of wide-ranging. I'm not sure if I'm going to formulate it clearly. But just wondering about how the... Maybe connecting with what Douglas just asked about avenues of seeking social change strategies. And I'm wondering about how to connect resistance to the death penalty with resistance to prisons and policing more generally. What Seth said about how the death penalty is an institution of racial slavery, just thinking about how that legacy continues today with incarceration as kind of a new slavery, just looking at how it's racially discriminatory. So I guess my question is, I wonder, thinking about these cultural narratives around the death penalty, in Danny's talk, you showed how this melodramatic trope of a kind of white innocent character played out, and that continues in a way in these more recent movies of with a white man who finds redemption, and just thinking about how sort of underside of that trope is seeing or associating guilt with blackness, like D.W. Griffith's other film, Birth of a Nation. So thinking about what sort of strategies then today are most effective for countering those narratives in contemporary contexts of neoliberal capitalism, with mass incarceration as kind of part of the counter revolution against the gains of the civil rights movement. I'm wondering, how we can think of countering that kind of white innocence melodramatic trope today. Or how that plays out today in culture, and how to counter it in movement strategies, I guess.
I love how invested people are in strategy, and I wish that I were at all qualified to offer anything but sort of sympathy and outrage. But I'm 100% not. Jen maybe would be a bit better qualified. Of course, Jen would be better qualified, he says, as he goes on to continue talking. I do want to say two quick things. One thing is that there's a real legislative strategy for getting things done that we've seen in North Carolina. We had the Racial Justice Act, which was defanged and then taken apart entirely. But this was an act of the legislature that enabled enabled prisoners to file claims saying that if there was a general context of racial discrimination around the death penalty, they had a legitimate claim to a commutation from a death sentence to a life sentence. And there were in excess of 250 claims submitted, and initial ones were validated as real, and people left death row. And you know, they went into life imprisonment, which is not fun. Not to be flip about it, it's terrible. But these were people who filed claims because they wanted to continue living. And so in that sense, that the Racial Justice Act was able to honor their desire to continue living, and it was a legitimate legislative fix that came from doing things like writing letters to politicians. Of course, because it was a legislative fix, it was also vulnerable to a legislative unfix, which is where we find ourselves today. One practical thing I think that we can do is we can go into prisons and talk to incarcerated persons about their experiences, thereby performing perhaps that risky act of personalization, but at the same time, when we sort of realize that these people in these situations are human beings, and I think crucially in my own experience, realizing that these people 25 years after their imprisonment are not the same human beings that they were when they were imprisoned at 16, for instance. One of the people that I met with this summer was a young man who had been in prison since he was 16 because he was tried in his adult, which we're not able to do anymore, but he has spent his entire young life in prison. And I think about all the profound ways I have changed since I was 16. I no longer smoke menthol cigarettes. Like there's pretty big differences in judgment between the post 16-year-old me and the 16-year-old me, and that is even realer when you are living in prison living in those along those routines and rituals. I will say that one fun fact about the sort of close ties between mass incarceration and enslavement is the fact that there were very few prisons in the South before 1865. And North Carolinians voted down by referendum three times the idea of building a prison as impractical and not worth the money before they were forced to write into their constitution by the United States government. The former Confederate North Carolina had to write into its constitution that it would build a prison. And they immediately decided that it would need to be built by the prisoners and it had to be self-sustaining. So needless to say, it wasn't built for about 30 years. But before that time, the idea that a white person would be compelled to labor in a confined space was completely unacceptable to the kinds of poor white potential criminals who would have ended up in prison if these prisons had been built. Because what was offered to them in exchange for their poverty at a time of great wealth, the South was the fourth richest nation in the world when the Civil War began because of slave labor, if you think of them as a nation. What those poor white people got in exchange for their poverty was white supremacy. And they could only accept imprisonment after that regime shifted gears with the defeat of the Confederate States of America. So quite literally, slavery ends and the move for imprisonment begins. It's an A then B kind of progression.
I like what Seth said about the documenting our clients' experiences in jail, who they are. I think a lot of this is about documentation. I think a lot of this is about witnessing. I think a lot of this is about community building. They don't sound like fancy answers, but they are real. It's, you know, organizing, community, witnessing and documenting. My staff, for years I ran an organization, this year I'm slowing it down, but for 10 years I ran an organization where I trained mitigation specialists and forensic investigators to work on death row cases. Often they would come to me and say, I'm really pissed off, I'm really upset, I can't get this witness to tell me the truth, I can't get this document, I've tried everything, they say it's missing, you know, it's from the flood or from a fire, and we know this document's going to show his IQ, and this is really going to help us, you know, because of Atkins. And I would ultimately always end up telling them, we are a witness. We're a witness to what is happening right now to our client. And ultimately, we just have to show up for this process and hope. We can't make evidence. We can't make a witness tell us the truth. But this is a really important part, too, because I'm standing next to my client, and I'm witnessing his struggle, and I'm watching him as he grows older, and I'm participating in his process, and I'm participating in my community with changes that I want to see in the prison. I'm developing a relationship with the guards, so they tell me about what's going on instead of being antagonistic, and I'm a zealot. I want to have a relationship with you because you house my client. So I'll be nice to you. And actually, just last week, one of those guards bummed a quarter off one of those guards to get water. So I went ahead and had water. I think you can build community with unsuspecting allies. And I think that ultimately, you know, I have friends who are cops and we argue about cases. And I say, well, why do you hide the evidence? I mean, just give it to the jury. That's just one person saying that he was in a diner in Ohio. You have everything else saying he wasn't. So we talk about it. I don't need to hate the cop. I need to talk to the cop. Because don't you want to get it right? Don't you want the right guy? Don't you understand why this is happening? So my answer is, and document, document, document. And I think we can learn from our leaders, leaders who have addressed race, leaders who have addressed change. And I think we should educate ourselves and go back and read those leaders and what they wrote. Aung San Suu Kyi, I want to say that's somebody I would read, who's a fantastic peace laureate. Malcolm X, I would read, you know. I would read some, where can you find your part in this process, in this evolution, in this radical shift, in what we want to see happen, because what's happening now is not okay. Let's document what's happening in the prisons. And I'm going to say this again. If you're a teacher, you're a social worker, you're out there working with these kids who are younger before they interact with this horrible system that we need to change, you know, get them, intervene, get them the help they need, document what help they need, just so that our jobs can be easier down the road as we're trying to fix this prison system. Thank you.
So I think sometimes I feel a little bit guilty about my thinking on this topic, Eli. Part of it is because I'm profoundly cynical about the U.S. electorate and public opinion. We know from public opinion polls that most Americans are not affected by the claims of racial injustice when they hear about why we should abolish the death penalty. We know that white Americans are not as moved by the innocence claims that now most of them are aware of in terms of their support for the death penalty, with many of them espousing to pollsters the view that you've got to essentially, you're always going to have mistakes, but that's just the way it goes with public policy. And part of that is because I do feel that there is a fundamental inability for many Americans to identify with or feel sympathy for those on death row who don't look like them, for many middle class Americans and don't have lives like them. Now, I'm not saying it's a lost cause and that the left should not work desperately to humanize, to make the points about why the system is broken that come out of our deep sense of racial justice and the way in which the death penalty has a history that is steeped in racial injustice. On the other hand, I think it's important to be cognizant of what works and what doesn't work. You know, we saw all those botched executions last year, and there was all this coverage of them, and people were saying, this is going to really kill support for the death penalty. The next poll comes out, the needle hasn't moved at all. In fact, support went up 1 or 2 points, not related to the botched executions. But it's very hard for people to identify with those on death row. And I think people do important work of trying to humanize them, but I think we have to engage conservative supporters of the death penalty on their own terms. And that, I think, means talking about the effects that this has on victims. I think it also means talking about the effect that it has on state budgets. I think that that ultimately has to be where a lot of the energy of abolitionism works. And part of the problem is that there's a way in which that can sometimes double down on life without parole, right? Because life without parole is what caused death sentences to decline dramatically in Houston. Once it was instituted in 2005, they went down dramatically when juries had that option. And so security and the obsession with security is still with us. I think it's very hard to unsettle it. I don't think we shouldn't stop trying, but I think we have to speak in terms that conservative or casual supporters of the death penalty will listen to. One other thought is that the psychology of punishment has shown us that punishment is satisfying when the person who is being punished acknowledges that they're being punished and then expresses remorse. That's an incredibly powerful element for people feeling as observers of an act of punishment, that A, punishment has happened, and B, that it's been meaningful. There's all these psychological studies that have been done that sort of suggest this. I think restorative justice movements can be powerful in the ways in which they deliver satisfaction to people who want to know that a moral reckoning has happened and who perhaps support the death penalty because they see it so dramatically as an act of moral reckoning. I think if there are ways that we can create opportunities for that moral reckoning to happen, that you will see a diminution of support for the death penalty, because I think the death penalty is where people turn to get that sense of moral satisfaction that they don't see in their everyday life. So I think restorative justice is really important. Right now we have a prison system where people are sentenced, there are emotional sentencing hearings, they're condemned, they can sometimes offer an apology, but then they're shipped into institutions and never heard from again, or occasionally, for the rare a capital defendant, they're executed 16 and a half years later. It's utterly unsatisfying. And I think if there's a way that we can make punishment something that fulfills the moral function that people want it to fulfill without doing, you know, all the damage that that mass incarceration does, we should pursue those ends.
So in your talk, you talked about the erasure of Black people in the cultural narratives of execution. And I was thinking, okay, what narratives have I seen? And then I remembered there was a film with Tom Hanks, I can't remember the title, and then the Shawshank Redemption, where the Black people seem to function as a way for the main white characters to find a moral awakening of some kind. So can you talk about that trend and why it starts or where it starts? And
Sure. Spike Lee coined the term the magical Negro to refer to African-American males who appear in films as sort of magical figures who help or become a foil to white men's spiritual and moral development. And in the case of Bagger Vance, their golf swing abilities. So there's this incredibly racist construction of African-Americans as these sort of godlike figures or having some kind of magical intuitive properties that then become, through an interaction with a white man who lacks soul or lacks a kind of understanding of himself, through that relationship, they gain something from it, and it becomes the occasion for these redemption narratives. So the Shawshank Redemption is an important example of that. The Green Mile, which I think is the film you were talking about with Tom Hanks, the Christ figure is an African-American man who is executed. And in some ways, that whole film is about erasing racial guilt. That this is a film that really takes the specter of the 1930s South as a place in which African-Americans were railroaded to death row and killed unceremoniously. And it undoes that narrative by giving us this character, Tom Hanks, who's suffering from a
from a bladder infection and then is cured by his interaction with this death row inmate, right, who allows him to have sex again with his wife, right? So you need to have this interaction with this death row figure in order to become cured. And this guy takes the pain of the world away and then, like Christ, is executed, right, as this in this moment where of transference, that then all of this guilt for racism, for all the hurt in the world that this character has nobly and willingly and happily borne for so long, is transferred onto Tom Hanks, who's punished by having to live a long time feeling guilty, right? So these death penalty films in the 90s are not, you know, they erase the racist past and present of the death penalty by, in many ways, showing us all three of these white characters are racists who lose their racism by undergoing an execution. So in these films, executions move from being a tool of racial domination to being a mechanism for purifying a culture of its racial sins. And I think the Green Mile is an important example of that.
So one quick question I had was, so this weekend I'm having a conversation with a few people from near my hometown, which is a small rural area in North Carolina, and somehow everything from capital punishment to mass incarceration to policing comes up. As you might expect, I start getting nervous because any second something offensive is going to happen, and it did. But so we're having a conversation, and the thing that I recognize quickly is this understanding and way of seeing the world where when I tried to provide examples of an alternative narrative where injustice is not the the exception, but is the frequent thing that occurs, they responded with a lot of defensiveness because they assume that justice usually happens, that life is supposed to be fair. And what I was met with was a frustrating inability to give them multiple examples to prove to them that this is not something that only sometimes happens, but it's constantly happening. So one question I have is there, you were sharing some stories about the countless trials that you've been a part of how just horrible the lack of evidence has been. Is there a resource for places that we can see and learn about these stories and these narratives so that we can then have a plethora to draw upon when we're in disagreements, conversations, whatever you want to say? Maybe a little bit, sure.
Chris, I love that question. Because that's what it comes down to, really, like backyard conversations. First, Death Penalty Resource Center. That's my answer. And you can write to me, and I will literally give you some outstanding material that is public record, affidavits that you can point to if you want to go down that road. They can watch the 48 hours coverage of my client, Damon Thibodeau, released after 15 years on death row for a crime he didn't commit, where I took a 19-page statement. They interview the real, who I believe to be the real killer, and how they just ignored him and moved on to my client and pushed him into a confession. And he's a truck driver now, and if I can give you his phone number, he'll probably talk to you because he's lovely and amazing that he is able to function after living 15 years on death row, 23 hours a day in solitary confinement, and get out after not having done that. The other side of this, though, is compassion. And I know it sounds trivial, but my family is very conservative. They support me, but when I started doing this work, I mean, they wanted me to go to law school and be a prosecutor. And my grandmother, the matriarch of my family, very Southern woman from New Orleans, I don't think so. Capital Post-Conviction Project, working on murderous cases, working with Sister Helen Prejean? No. Not in this family. And my family taught me to love. They taught me to give. They ran churches. They, you know, helped the homeless. But you don't help a murderer. You know, and so at the dinner table, they would ask questions and then skip over me. My brother, you know, IRS agent, good job. You know, and there you go, right, my cousin Mandy, lawyer, workers' comp or something. Good job. Jen, black sheep, murderers or something. She's going to tell us some story. You're not going to believe what I learned today. You're not going to believe this, but the hammer's missing off the gun. They don't, you know. So there's, you know, this disconnect with me and them that's grown over time. In the beginning, I had to yell and scream and say, you don't understand. Here's the facts. This is what's wrong. Here's the paper. Here's the proof. They don't care. I'm leaning up because I want to see you. They don't really care until they're ready to care. And what changed was me. I was more available for my grandparents to play dominoes and hear their stories about growing up in the lower Ninth Ward and what happened in that community that was a result of poverty and racism, that then they started getting angry, feeling like, oh, well, this is happening to me. So I just let them tell their stories, and I found that the less racist they were and the less more they understood about mental illness, more they understood about poverty, the more available they were to understand what's wrong with the system, because they're a part of it. We are a part of it. And if we're not going to accept that responsibility, no one's going to tell us what's really wrong. So be a friend to them. Hear their why. Why do you think it's so just? What's, you know, hear about their life. Throw in a few tidbits. Hey, did you see that story about Damon Thibodeau? Because, man, 15 years on death row, innocent, something's wrong there. So anyway, you were telling me, so it's going on at the post office. You hate the person? Compassion and love. That's fine. Long answer.
Time to wrap it up. So,
produced by Duke University, online at duke.edu.